Terry with the butterfly now picked up on him. They're going to start the fight off the right way by jumping on Chaotuji. Remember, he's got his ultimate. Buyback. He's not going to pop it yet. He's got the abyssal as well. He won't use anything. He'll go down.
No buyback.
No buyback. Oh, man. LGD, it was their turn to blunder a bit earlier, but this may have been the bigger blunder on the Juggernaut. No Aegis, no cheese, no buyback, and no way out.
They got cocks. They got Dragon Slave, they got Acid Spray. Let's see how good this stuff is.
We're about to see if the cogs are imba or not. And I think the answer is not when LGD just walk around them, which bottom lane is a wider choke you can easily do. Stun gets lobbed in, we'll connect on G. They'll take this Ranger X first. Doesn't really matter. They should be able to get one lane of racks off of this, which won't necessarily end the game, but gives them a commanding advantage. They may take two though. 50 seconds on Juggernaut. Hard to say if LGD can bring the second one down. They're going to try for it, though. By golly, they want to end this game now. They've got that slight opening. The window has been propped up, and they just want to close it now on Rising Stars. Don't let them fight one more time. Don't let them get another pickoff. The cogs are there. LGD trying to force that game three. XDD pulled on the wrong side of the cogs. Will get picked off, and not where he wanted to be, for sure. Brax able to vacuum bag, and now they're going to work on that tower. Epicenter being channeled. Blink in for Misery, but it only goes on to Air, who is BKB'd. Misery gets blown up, zapped in the face for his trouble. But maybe it's all just about running interference here.
These birds are doing so much damage, and the illusions are right there as well. Air going to toss out another stun. That's going to get BKB by Piecat. Piecat's low. He does have a heart. Super can zap in, and he's going to try to self-disrupt. He does. Just barely, though. There's cheese up on the Alchemist. He has to man-fight this. His ultimate is out, and look at the Templar Assassins focusing on the Rex. Finally, they're going to get double Rex. Chaotuji is back, but can he be enough for the team? And he's so damn slow, these traps. Force that forward against G. G Melstrike dodges now. There's a Burrowstrike coming back, and LSA is going to miss BKB on Chaotuji. He wants to man fight, but look at the crits coming out. He has to Omni GG slash, but it's not enough. Trying to spin out of there, and he also is going to go down a meltdown against Rising Star. And it's going to be a meteoric fall as they crash and burn. And it looks like LGD have somehow salvaged this late game, which it looked really dicey for a long time there.
I gotta say, I felt they were somewhat handed it there. Yeah. And not having buyback on your hard carry Juggernaut, farming that bottom lane with no tier 2 up. But LGD, credit where credit is due. Their early game in particular was sensational. Amazing movement by Misery. I also want to credit Misery again for that two-hero Burrow Strike, because I think Juggernaut actually could have assassinated two heroes and maybe helped Rising Stars claw their way back into this game. But now it's just fountain farming for LGD, and it's going to be smooth sailing from here, and a triple kill for Piecat at the fountain. Rising Stars, they'll finally tap out. They have been thoroughly defeated. LGD, they improved their record at 40-minute games to 7-13, which, again, still not the best record there, but they get an important win, and maybe this will be sort of that game where, hey guys, in the end, we pulled it together when it counted in the clutch. We go to game three, we feel confident.
It's so ironic how Rising Star made a comeback was a smoke gank right before the Roshan fight.
Because that's what LGDN normally does.
Yeah, and then LGDN, they smoke gank right after the Aegis timed out. They definitely marked down the timing. They're like, oh, no Aegis on Juggernaut, let's go for him. They got it, and that was it.
Great play from LGD. I mean, I would just say I liked how they drafted for G, because they got him the TA. Right. I hear they can snowball. And I feel like this team just needs kind of that kick in, you know, that something extra, that turbo boost, that snowball hero, whatever you want to call it, that little bit to get them over the hump and get them started off the right way. And they certainly had it. G was 9-0, ends up 15-3-9. Great performance from him. Had a lot of help from his team. Overall for LGD, everybody mostly pulling their weight this game. There was that one fight where they overextended at the Roche or at the base really badly, but aside from that, they played well.
Yeah, it was. Sometimes when you play this kind of early game lineup, those one mistake is very detrimental. But looks like they were able to pull it out, and we're going to game three, and that's.
I'm
we haven't
excited.
Had a game three here for DSL for a long time, right?
We haven't. It's been the Dota 2 Super League, an amazing tournament, but I gotta say the games have not lived up to it yet. I imagine they will in the playoffs.
Yeah,
but
we have Orange DK coming up soon as well.
Yeah, that one could be amazing, but it has been a lot of stomps, to be honest. We'll see.
This was a fairly exciting game.
Not these two games. Even game one was, I felt, fairly close at points for LGD. They couldn't take it in the end. They do take game two, guys, and now the North American European transplants. Can they bring it all the way to a satisfying conclusion? Can they take game three, or is Rising Stars going to bounce back? We're going to find out right after this break. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Game 3. It's going to be LGD versus Rising Stars, your final, well, not your final match, your second-to-last match of the Dota 2 Super League group stages, the $165,000 coming-out party for the Perfect World organizers. And it looks like the game will load. Kawa was throwing us to the wolves. He ran the intro early before it loaded. It goes through in the end, so shout-out to Kawa for being a jerk. Screw you, Kawa. But I'm LD. I'm joined here by Lumi. And Lumi, Game 3, who's your money on?
Rising Stars. I think Rising Star is... What's going on, Kawa?
It's in. You're good. Wait, that's what we said.
That's.
Go home, Kawa. You're drunk. Go ahead.
Are you okay?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Are you done? Can we cast the game now?
Okay. All right, it looks like we could cast now. Kawa just gave us the green light. I think Rising Star, not because I favor the Chinese team more, but because I think they've been playing better today. In their game one loss, they play okay. It was a pretty close game. In their game one win, they were kind of stomping hard. In the game two loss, they were almost even bringing it back. There was some great smoke plays. Perhaps it was a couple mistakes made by LGN. But just on the two games so far here today, I think Rising Star is playing better Dota. So I think they could win the series.
Yeah, for LGDN, I would have to agree. I think it comes down to, do they get that better draft? Do they have that fast start?
Right.
If they don't, I think the game gets quite hard for them.
There's so many ifs and buts and ands. It's just...
If I had to put money on it, I would say Rising Stars, but I wouldn't want to bet a lot of money on it.
It's
not
like
the odds were pretty decent.
55-45 kind of thing.
It's not like we're saying 80-20 Rising Stars take this. They haven't been that impressive. And LGDN, they will start this one off with the Lifestealer, so... Does this change the equation for you, Lumi?
I mean, in game number one, we saw Lifestealer being an opening pick, and then Storm Stray eventually cleaning up. Now, G does, if you don't know, plays a very good Storm. And
G invented Storm Spirit, all right?
He did.
I mean, Gods would argue with that and
Blitz,
say MMY Blitz, is the best Storm.
Blitz would argue against that as well, yeah. But yeah, Gods really invented the Bloodstone Storm. And
Not Gods. God killed them all, but yeah.
Well, God, yeah.
The other God. Yeah.
Well, we're going to see Alchemist and Darks here. So a ton of team fight, a ton of base defense, and more importantly, very stellar lanes right from the get-go.
Yes, pretty strong lanes for them. And up against Lifestealer, some good control as well. You've got the minus armor from Poison Spray, which is obviously fantastic against Lifestealer, as well as the physical damage from the stun. So it'll be a pretty potent combo to deal with them. And then also Surge, one of the best ways to deal with Dark Lifestealer. Question is, do LGD go Storm now? Because I feel like if they don't, Rising Stars will probably ban it out in the second stage.
I feel like they go Nyx Assassin now. It's a great hero that gives you more mid-game ganking power with a conjunction with the Lifestealer. Mana Burn is exceptional against Darkseer because his mana pool is pretty shoddy. And being an intelligence hero, he's going to take a lot of mana burning. So maybe you just run a solo mid Nyx Assassin on G if that's what you want to do. But
We'll have to wait and see. I mean, the one issue for me with going something like Nyx is... Again, it's just not that, it's that it's a hero that can have a powerful start. It can be a big nuisance, but most of the time, it's hard for Nyx nowadays to really get out of control if he goes mid. Because if he goes mid, it's obvious when he's missing, because there's no Nyx in the lane. Whereas if he's a support Nyx, could disappear into the jungle, things like that. The Go Queen of Pain, and I actually like this better because I think it just suits G more. He's a player like Mushi, sort of like Korok, where they want that kind of DPS, intelligent semi-carry, snowball type of hero. And so I think this is a slightly better fit.
Yeah, critically, you're going to get your quick Orchids, which is going to be the big deal against Darkseer, Alchemist, and more importantly, it's a bus for that Lifestealer to come in melee close and get up and personal. I'm surprised that Rising Star actually banned that Shadow Demon. I thought that's the hero that they want against this sort of lineup coming out from LGN, but we'll see what they're going to go from here as well. I'm surprised completely the Lifestealer not being countered by the Shadow Demon.
Yeah, we'll see. And now Rising Star is actually the ones just to ban it out themselves. So feeling confident that they don't need it and they don't want to have to play against it. He is kind of annoying versus Alchemist as well. Again, being a melee carry, he can be kited fairly easily by that. Also, Alchemist almost always builds Assault Cuirass. And this is something that Disruption is going to counter because you'll get a copy of that Alchemist aura for your own team. So somewhat makes sense. And of course, decent against Darkseer in the tri lanes, but not a ban worth talking any more about. Weaver, the ban here for LGDN. My question for you is, what is LGDN going for now? They've got their Lifestealer to be that tri-lane component for Brax. It could be a safe lane farmer for Pycat, but I imagine Pycat will probably play something else and they'll run this as an aggressive tri-lane Lifestealer that seems more like LGDN to me. So then my question is, what's going to go with the Lifestealer and what's Pycat going to play?
I imagine something that runs along the line of a Chen or Enchantress.
Ooh.
And just... do a ton of early game pressure because you have basically your latest game hero is Lifestealer and Queen of Pain so far, and that's not late at all. Like, you could get going right at the 10 minute mark, and if you could take down tier 1 and start to take down tier 2 towers, you secure the enemy Roshan for yourself with Chen creeps. I think it could be a very, very kind of offensive lineup for them to play. And it's like you said, LG not exactly known for their late game power. And that's exactly what Rising Star is going for. They're banning out the late game heroes like Prophet. They want to go late game. They want to go as late as possible, especially against Queen of Pain. Because what is Queen of Pain going to do 35, 40 minutes in?
Yeah, if Alchemist gets to that point where he's got Assault Cuirass, you know, you're looking at your Basher, your Heart of Tarrasque,
right.
Your Manta Style, whatever the items are.
Queen you get Pain's to certain, Hexer?
Yeah, you hex him, and then he just sits there and doesn't lose health.
Right.
And
yeah.
In Chemical Ridge with all the regen from Heart. Or whatever the case might be. Rubick will be the pick for Rising Stars, and I actually love this pick because it's going to allow them to gank Queen of Pain. You lift her up,
yeah.
And if the follow-up stuns are there, you can actually bring her down. It's that instant disable, which oftentimes teams are lacking against mobile heroes like Queen of Pain.
Yeah, a big kind of thing so far for Rising Stars is that they don't lack an AoE. Last game, I thought they had too much single target because I was more enticed by that Hook, Laguna Blade, all the single target ultimates, but from the repeated base defense we saw Acid Spray, Dragon Slave, and all that stuff. And similar in this game, they have a lot of ways to defend towers, and I think that's going to be their path to victory. Keep defending, and take it to the late game. It might change very easily in this fourth and fifth pick, but so far that seems to be their game plan.
I mean, they can angle more for the mid game if they want. Darkseer can rush a mech, Alchemist can go mech, and Darkseer can even go for something like a Pipe fairly early, the Arcane Boots before that. Alchemist can go Shadowblade. They can angle mid-game, but I'm with you. I think if you're Rising Stars, you look at LGD as a team, and you look at this draft, and you say, we will have a better shot at winning this if we angle for late-game. They go for Puck now, and now that puts Alchemist into a farming role. Now that really shores up their team fight. Dream Coil, Waning Rift, Vacuum, Wall, Acid Spray layered over top, whatever Rubick can steal, which, oh, by the way, he could steal a Burrow Strike.
Sonic Wave, Burrow Strike.
That's a lot of good stuff.
Yeah.
So I think Rising Stars, if this goes to that 35-40 minute mark, I would be willing to bet a lot of money they'll take it. I think that's about the maximum point where I would expect LGDN to win the game, but of course we could be surprised.
Yeah. Also, with the Sand King being picked up, I think Misery will be playing that, so most likely we won't be seeing any jungle hero. And with the assumption of Sand King being handled by Misery, I imagine we see something like Latrak being played by 1437. That's a hero that he's very good at, and that's your kind of dual core roaming combo. SK, Latrak with Lifestealer. Maybe that lane lacks quite a bit in terms of initiation power, so maybe you want a support that gives you a longer initiation, like a Jakiro?
It can definitely work as a combo if you smoke and you come through the tree line or around a corner.
Right.
Later on, it's easy, but yeah, you're right. At level 1, it's not the strongest dual roam, so we'll see what they go for here. And the other question is, what's that Pycat hero going to be? Gyrocopter's in the pool. Oh, sorry, actually Gyrocopter's banned, but Lone Druid is in the pool. We saw Pycat once upon a time play a Klynx. We'll actually see the Chen, so This now puts Brax onto the Lifestealer, most likely. The Sand King for, I guess it's going to be for 1437.
Yeah,
so a five-position Sand King, and then the Chen for Misery.
What about Lycanthrope?
Ooh.
It's a hero that they're really, really good at. I think LGN definitely is the best Lycan team in the world. Like, well, that's not saying much because nobody used Lycan. But they know how to push this hero to the button. They know how to split push very well.
Yeah.
And you know you're going to get the quick Vlad. It goes very well with Chen. And
if you pick Lycan here, my question is, how do you shut down Darkseer in the laning stage? That's going to be the big concern. Because Lycan cannot do a thing against that hero. You have to devote Sand King to helping. And Sand King
doesn't
can't help. So basically, Chen has to lane against Darkseer. He's got to constantly send creeps there. He'll slow down his own farm. They can't really go for smoke ganks. I don't think it fits just because of the lanes. You're right. It's a hero
tough.
That they've used. But against the Darkseer, with the supports they have, I think it's too much of a liability in the laning stage.
Yeah, I think they need some sort of range carry or something that could harass from far.
Maybe even something like I mentioned a Klynx. I think it wouldn't
be.
Sure,
yeah.
We've seen Funnik has beaten Darkseer safely, and you pull the Klynx early. So he starts with the Wraith Ban. It's possible for Klynx to be Darkseer safe lane. That allows them to run the aggressive
Trial. Oh my god.
Okay. We're going to see a Triant. So Rising Stars, now their team fight. I know a lot of people think Overgrowth isn't that great of a team fight ability because it doesn't
so
do damage.
Good. It's so good.
It's great against Lifestealer.
Yep.
They have Surge to deal with Lifestealer. They have Overgrowth to deal with him. They have Acid Spray to deal with him. They have the elusiveness of Puck to deal with him.
Yep.
This is a team that has a lot of tools for Lifestealer. So LGD, they can't put too many eggs in the Lifestealer basket. I think they need to pick up a third here they can kind of scale a bit as well.
And they don't have much time left. They're running quite low.
7 seconds.
Well, they have
or 14. 14.
They have 7 second reserve as well. So we'll just wait with bated breath what this last pick is. Lycanthrope Cillian doesn't look good anymore at all, even if you find a lane for him. But it's going to be a Shadow Fiend, so...
This is good. You mentioned a range carry. This is similar, actually better, I would say, than a Klinks at actually zoning a Darkseer out.
He's great, yeah.
Not at level 1, but if you get... We've seen CTY do this before on the safe lane Shadow Fiend. You get to level 3, you have a couple of souls, level 5. Darkseer tries to dive you, and you just triple raise him and kill him.
Yep, you need is like a single Burrow Shrike to set things up, and then it's just easy peasy from that point on.
We've actually seen CTY solo kill a Darkseer offlane now. I don't know if that'll happen.
Well, here's the thing. Is he going to solo kill anything with the Living Armor online?
That's true. That is the X factor here. Well, means the raises may not be very effective. But guys, it is going to be Game 3, Rising Stars versus LGD Ant. This one's for all the marbles. Rising Stars, they take this game, they bounce back, they'll move on to the playoffs. If LGD Ant can muster their courage and somehow... work their way into a victory here, then they will be the ones who advance to the playoffs. These teams are duking it out for third place. For Group A, things have already been set. We've finished up our group stages there. In Group B, it's going to be DK as well as Orange. Duking it out for first and second place. They are guaranteed to be the top 1-2. The only question is going to be the order. So for Rising Stars, we'll introduce their players after this pause. Lumi, looking at the draft and looking at the camera. What do you think? What do you think about this game? Do you have a favorite?
I personally like Treant. I'm like the other David of the BTS, where one day
we have to balance out gods because he's such a hater.
He's such a hater.
It's kind of insane.
Like how you love Dreams and Mineski and you put them in the Eastern qualifier. I balance you out, you know, with the obvious.
With your Pinoy pride.
Right, there you go. I personally like Treant quite a bit. I know a lot of people out there saying, hey, but you could rage and break out of, you know, Overgrowth and things like that. But a lot of time when Lifesteal walks in, he opens wounds and he rage. You have to pop the rage early to kind of dodge, initiate it.
And you need the attack speed as well. Right. It's a lot of your damage.
So as a Treant, you can basically just wait until that rage comes out and then you just Overgrowth.
And you can use things like Surge to kind of kite the Lifestealer, out the rage, Puck and Orb, Phase Shift away. They have a lot of ways to do with this Lifestealer, but that's why I like what LGDN did, because they're not relying too much on him. They go back for the Shadow Fiend here. They've got a tri-core lineup. They've got three heroes with a lot of damage, some good mobility, especially if you go phase drums on Lifestealer, which I imagine is kind of this 2 or 3 position. We'll probably see that. Mm-hmm. I think what LGD have done is the smart way to play this game out. They're not going to have the better team fight, so they're going for just burst damage, tri-core, split push. Somebody hopefully just gets the ball rolling. And then from there, they just muscle their way to victory.
Yeah, I think a lot of it is in the Shadow Fiend basket because he's going to have all the protection. He's playing the one row. He's going to have Sion King backing him up. He's going to have Chen backing him up from the jungle. Normally, you say Darkseer can't win that lane at all. I mean, Darkseer, you think he can win the lane with Iron Shell and all that stuff, but a single Burrow Strike out of jungle, you're dead. But on the flip side, you also have Living Armor. So I haven't seen this matchup really come out, so I don't know how that lane goes. And in my opinion, that is the lane that determines the entire game. That's the biggest important lane to me.
I think he really should win it, especially if they pull him, if he gets any kind of help early from the Sand King, the Chen. It should be a free farm Shadow Fiend by all rights. We'll see what Rising Stars do here. We'll hop ourselves back inside the game, guys. Again, Game 3, this one for all the marbles. Air going to be playing that solo mid Puck for Rising Stars. We saw him off lane on the Puck in Game 1. He'll be taking the mid role, his customary position this time around. XDD, back to that off lane role as the Darkseer. On the safe lane, we'll have Xiao Tuji playing the farming Alchemist. We'll see how greedy he gets this game, how many points of Grievous Greed he'll go for. Mophi on the Rubick, and last but not least, it's going to be Super on that 4-position Treant Protector.
Meanwhile, here on the Radiant side, it's going to be Brax handling the Lifestealer. I thought he was going to be solo Lifestealer up top, Suicide Lane. It might still be so. Maybe the supports are kind of hanging out with him.
I think it'll be a dual roam from LGD Ant here, and... Well, actually, no smoke, some misery, so maybe not.
Maybe they're just jungling here. Speaking of misery, he's going to be playing that Chen. And, of course, we have Sanky being handled by 1437. Of course, solo mid, as always, is going to be G. Playing the Queen of Pain was pulled by a couple of points of regen. And last but not least, it's going to be Pycat playing that one roll Shadow Fiend bot.
Yeah, he'll be going for early Tranquil Boots. He's expecting Darkseer in lane. For the time being, it looks like Darkseer is going to be there. XDD on the bottom lane, and... Well, we'll see how much he can do. This is where Darkseer, level 2, 3, he's got to find them quickly. Because once Pycat starts to get some damage from the passive, and once he gets his level 2 raise, it's actually quite hard for Darkseer to stay in lane, especially with the threat of a Burrow Strike. For the time being, though, there is a ward up, so he should be okay. Brax on the run top lane, but should be fine. So, LGD Ant, I like how they're running the Lifestealer off lane, because it's the one thing about this hero that's still very strong is... hard to kill in the offlane with Rage, and probably should be able to get some levels here, and that frees you up to run something greedy like a Shadow Fiend safe lane.
Double Iron Shell here, as XCD does not care about the 1437 Harass. He doesn't need to care because he has all the regen. He has Living Armor. They could actually trade hits. Burrow Strike goes off here. XCD says, I got Living Armor, man. Yeah, you go the other way. The biggest thing for me is that, for whatever reason, Rising Star did not start with Sentry Wards, and their pool just got warded off by this particular ward, and they won't have EXP. For your level 1 Treant and your level 1 Rubick, who aren't gankers, like, what are you going to do, gank with Living Armor? You're going to really fall behind in terms of EXP compared to a Chen that's Rising away in the jungle.
And for the Dire side, it's nearly impossible to pull the safe camp unless you get the poison creep, so... you can't really rely on that secondary pull, which means, like you said, they're just not getting a whole lot. They may try and pull this camp right here. Mophie's going to draw the aggro. Is the timing right?
No, it's wrong.
He didn't tango through, and it won't be in time. And this lane's going to push. That's a lot of experience going his way. And normally the Darkseer is sort of your X factor here. He'll get more out of the offlane than even something like a Lifestealer. But this game looks like it should be even, or maybe even favoring that Lifestealer.
Yeah, but Rising Star supports making early blunders. Rubick picks up the immediate... He's still even upgrade a Courier. That's how important they need the Sentry Ward right now, and it's walking there. And of course, XCD is still absolutely fine on this bot lane. He's got that very critical level too, so he shouldn't really die here anymore. But look at PyCat. His farming 8-5, not bad.
He won't die now. He can definitely die when PyCat hits level 3, maybe level 5. Once you get to that point, doesn't matter if Darkseer Surge. He gets Burrow Striked, you double triple raise, he'll just die. So.
Well, he still have Living Armor, assuming that Super doesn't fall asleep during that time, so.
We'll see. Yeah, I mean, I guess if he's at full HP, maybe not. But yeah. PyCat should be able to deliver the harassment, the pain as well. And for the time being, PyCat 9-7 despite last day under his tower. And it's always about those first few waves of Shadow Fiend. You do well on those, and things are smooth sailing. You struggle at first, and sometimes you can get frustrated. But he's off to a good start. At the same time, so too is Xiaotuji. 14-1, maxing greed first, not leveling the stun up too much just yet. Only 1 point in that. And for Rising Stars, I still feel their best path to victory here is just angle for maximum late game.
Yeah, and they gotta shut down Lifestealer a little bit harder in the top lane. Once Lifestealer, for example, gets his face boots, this lane is absolutely impossible, because what is the support gonna do against a phased Lifestealer that can run in and out of lane? They can even harass him back, and right now, look at Braxis.
They're gonna go in right now. Oh.
Oh, no, he's fine.
Can't quite kill off XDD, but I mean, you do see the potential there to just blow him up all of a sudden is quite present.
Yeah, he will need to get that salve. I wonder if he's going to go Soul Ring. That's generally the absolute standard item build. Sometimes players like to go for Bottle if you want a little bit more burst regen.
But we'll have to see what he goes for the time being. Just continuing to get what experience and gold he can out of this lane. We'll have another pause, this time from LGDN. Quick disconnect from G. And Lumi, what do you make of the game so far? Gold-wise, 100 gold lead for the Radiant. Experience-wise, 750 lead for them. The one hero we haven't looked at too much is Misery's Chen. Level 3.5 at 3 minutes in, he's off to a pretty fast start.
Yeah, I mean, you know they're not going to be ganking. We didn't see any smokes early on. Sentry, or only a single Clarity up on Chen. He just wanted to hit that quick level.